Good morning and welcome to our online worship here at St. James. We are so glad that you've chosen to join us today. And we hope you'll join in our opening hymn, Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of Creation. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join in the song of the three young men, our song of praise today. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son came into the world that he might destroy the works of the devil and make us children of God and heirs of eternal life, grant that having this hope, we may purify ourselves as he is pure, that when he comes again with power and great glory, we may be made like him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the prophet Amos. Thus says the Lord, the God of hosts, the Lord, alas, for you who desire the day of the Lord, why do you want the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light, as if someone fled from a lion and was met by a bear, or went into the house and rested a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. Is not the day of the Lord darkness, not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I hate, I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the offerings of well-being of your fatted animals, I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. The word of the Lord. The psalm for today is Psalm 70. Be pleased, O God, to deliver me.
O Lord, make haste to help me.
Let those who seek my life be ashamed and altogether dismayed.
Let those who take pleasure in my misfortune draw back and be disgraced.
Let those who say to me, aha, and gloat over me turn back,
because they are ashamed.
Let all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you.
Let those who love your salvation say forever, great is the Lord.
But as for me, I am poor and needy.
Come to me speedily, O God.
You are my helper and my deliverer.
O Lord, do not tarry. A reading from the first letter to the Thessalonians. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we are who we are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, 'Look, here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him.' Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise replied, 'No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves.' And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he replied, 'Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour.' The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ."
Ten bridesmaids, 5 wise and 5 foolish. That's what Pastor Chris just read to us today. But here's the question I have. How do we know? Or to put it differently, Jesus has to tell us that there are 5 of each in this story, because isn't it all obvious from the outside? All of them were prepared for the wedding feast. They had their dresses, the flowers, and their lamps were lit. They were all ready for the celebration. We can't tell the wise from the foolish from the outside. It is only when the party is late, when the bridegroom is late in coming, that we find out that some were prepared for such an occasion and some weren't. In the midst of what a vast majority of the country agreed was a hugely important election for our country, it is very easy to think of those who voted like I did as the wise, and those who didn't as the foolish. It's easy to use Matthew's language that focuses on insiders and outsiders, good and bad, those who hear Jesus's words and follow them, and those who don't. Or in this case, as prepared or unprepared. and apply that language to the partisanship with which we are all living in our country right now. But the meaning of this parable suggests a very different way of seeing things. For the wise and foolish cannot be told by the Trump or Biden signs in their yard. They can't be told because of people who voted straight ticket or split their ballot. The wise, says Jesus, are those prepared for what is next, for the journey still yet to come. The wise bridesmaids are those who are ready for the long haul and not just for the moment. The wise among us right now are those who are ready to continue working to build God's kingdom. In the words of Amos today, there are those who will make justice roll down like water and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. The wise today are those who do not stop doing what they think is right to make our neighborhoods, our towns and cities, our country and our world look more like God's kingdom. What differentiates the wise from the foolish is not what we have done in the past, how much we have, how we have voted, even how smart we are. No, what Jesus says in this parable is that what separates us is how ready we are. Are we prepared for what is to come or are we not? But what does it look like to be prepared? This is a parable. It's not to be read literally, so let's not worry too much about lamps or their modern day equivalents. If we are waiting for Jesus, the bridegroom, to arrive, what does it look like to be ready? We heard last week what Jesus thinks about being ready. We heard his very first sermon, the Sermon on the Mount, which Patty did a wonderful job of discussing in her sermon. Readiness looks like those who are peacekeepers, those who show mercy, those who work for righteousness, those who show they are poor in spirit by walking through this life with humility. Now, near the end of his ministry, Jesus is adding to that original message, the one he lived for 3 years, bringing healing and compassion to those who were sick and in mourning, calling for justice and righteousness, forgiving even those who hated him, and proclaiming a gospel of peace and love. For 3 years, he has shown and taught the disciples, taught us how to live this way. And now we are near the end. Jesus is about to be arrested. And so he is telling us something else. It isn't enough to do these things once. We must be in it for the long haul. We don't know when the bridegroom is coming. We do know that when we push for peace in one situation, new kinds of violence will occur. When we work for justice for those most in need of it, other groups will still be victimized. Being merciful once, writing a letter to an elected official, or attending a rally or protest, these are easy and maybe even fun. But Jesus warns that this is a lifetime, many lifetimes, in fact, of work. We will not see it completed while we walk the earth, but we have the opportunity to be among those who, over time, bring healing to a broken world. So there are two things I think this parable is saying to us today. Whether you are elated, relieved, angry, dismayed, or simply glad that the election's over, the work isn't done. And it won't be done in 2024 or 2028 either. Take time to care for yourself. Pray. Find silence. Eat well and exercise. Because as the Apostle Paul also tells us, this is a long distance race that we are running. There's going to be plenty to do, and we, St. James, need to be a part of it. Find the things that excite you and feed your soul, and be ready to keep building God's kingdom. Second, this is the twist to this whole narrative that I was elated to have immediately identified by the group who does Bible study on Wednesdays. I have to tell you, actually, that I'm starting to think they really don't need me to add anything to their conversation. The wise bridesmaids are ready. They brought that extra oil just in case. They happened to have the thing that was needed this time round. But then they did the exact opposite of everything Jesus teaches. They refused to share from what they have. What if there had been a different change to the plans? What if instead of things being late and needing more oil, the limousine had broken down? And it turned out that some bridesmaids knew how to change a tire and some didn't. Would different bridesmaids then be wise and different foolish? Jesus' message is not about actually being wise or foolish. It is always to not hoard what we have in case we need it someday, but to trust that the community has everything we need to be who we are called to be. We already have peacemakers. We already have those working for righteousness, those bringing healing, and those who lead with humility. We also have great resources and wisdom and so many good things that we've been blessed with. According to our catechism, the church is called to reconcile all people to God and one another. Recognizing that we need to be church for the world as it is today and for tomorrow, we are just beginning work on a visioning plan to identify together how we will love one another and the world outside of St. James. The new vestry, when they are elected in January, will be taking this up as soon as the elections happen. And we'll be asking all of you to join in on the process. We need the whole community, both in and out of St. James, to do the work that is in front of us, if we are to be among the wise. So do what you need to do to be well this week. Celebrate or mourn. Give yourself some space, some time. And then consider how you have been gifted by God. And what ways you can show gratitude by using those gifts to be a part of reconciling our community and nation so that we can grow and heal and work toward becoming a new creation together. And now, let us affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The prayers of the people. With the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. God of love, you gather us in spirit when we cannot meet in person. Be with Michael, our presiding bishop, Bonnie, our bishop, our partner churches who worship around this diocese, our companion diocese in the Dominican Republic, and all those around the world. Teach your people to be a community of grace and witness. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Your church is a place of relationship. We pray for all those who worship with us and support the ministry of St. James. We pray for our clergy, staff, and leadership, for volunteers and partners in ministry. Give us understanding that we might care for each other with our whole heart. Unite us in bonds of truth, peace, and faith. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Your creation is a precious gift. Turn our hearts to use its resources wisely rather than hoarding them for our own selfish gain. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Your desire for us is peace. Be with all those newly elected, re-elected, or continuing in public service. Give them the ability to see the world as it is, the humility to learn from people who differ from them, and the strength to make decisions that help build our kingdom. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Your ways are goodness and life. Free Jamie and all those on our prayer list from illness, hurt, anxiety, or addiction. Help them become whole parts of your creation and fill them with your love. We especially lift up those we name now. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Your promise to us is resurrection. We commend to your mercy all who have died, especially Lynn Webster, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Trusting in your mercy and goodness, we bring before you these prayers and all those good things that you see we need. In the name of the one who showed us your love, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Merciful God, we have sinned in what we have thought and said, in the wrong we have done, and in the good we have not done. We have sinned in ignorance, we have sinned in weakness, we have sinned through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry. We repent and turn to you. Forgive us for our Savior Christ's sake, and renew our lives to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit keep you in eternal life. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. We are so glad to have so many of you worshiping with us today. We apologize for having cut the second lesson. That was a technical error, and I'm told that it can be fixed in the archive. So if you go back and look at this service down the road, it should be fixed. As always, please send any prayer requests, questions about tech, or any of your needs or concerns to prayer@stjamesbirmingham.org. Also, this Wednesday at 10 o'clock, we're going to be having a service to give thanks for our veterans and all those who chose to give of themselves to serve this country. You can find that on our Facebook page. And if you would like to honor someone who served, please email their name to prayer@stjamesbirmingham.org by Tuesday night. That's prayer@stjamesbirmingham.org. Tomorrow, there is going to be a drive-up COVID testing in Pontiac. Also, there'll be free flu shots available there, food and masks to assist those who are getting tested or their shots will also be available. If you'd like to donate for any of the food or masks, please take them to the Gable House anytime before 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. And you can find their address in the directory or contact me and I'd be happy to give it to you. Thank you so much for supporting this really important ministry as we work to keep all of our neighbors safe. Also, as I mentioned last week, we're again providing sandwiches each Saturday for people in Pontiac. Those get made usually on Thursday night or sometimes Friday morning, and you can help to make them by signing up using the link in the light. Also, a new program that we are supporting, shoes are being collected to go to help micro businesses get started up. These are really important ways to help budding entrepreneurs get out of poverty. And if you have the desire to clean out your house a little, to look in the back of your closet and find shoes that you've not worn for a while that are still in pretty good shape, we ask that you would drop them in the marked bin near the Martin Street entrance, and we will pass them on to this great program that helps out these micro businesses. And now for the really good news. It's my delight to inform you, if you haven't seen it already, that both Pastor Chris and Patty Fraley have been officially approved for ordination. Chris's ordination will be at St. James on November 18th at 7 o'clock p.m. She will be ordained to the priesthood, and the service will be live streamed both on our website and Facebook pages. So right wherever you're watching this service today, you should be able to watch it on Wednesday night, November 18th, so a week from Wednesday. Patty's going to be ordained to the diaconate on Saturday, December 19th. That's the Saturday before Christmas, and that will be at the cathedral in Detroit. We don't have all the details yet about the time, but there will be a live stream as well that day. And we obviously will let you know as soon as we know the details of how to view that service. I have to say how proud I am of both of these members of the St. James community, how thankful they are for the support they've received from all of you. They have done so much hard work, and they continue to learn and grow and serve. If you would like to contribute toward the church's ordination gifts to them, you can send a check to the church with ordination gift on the memo line, or better yet, you can donate on our website and use that same designation. Just put ordination gift as the memo. Also, more good news. We hope if all goes well, the plan is to be able to live stream next Sunday from the church. So you'll see our service in the same platforms on Facebook and our website. But it will be filmed entirely live instead of partly live and partly recorded, and it will be from the church, from our sanctuary. This project to improve the sound and allow for live streaming is very close to completion, and we are so excited to be able to show you our live space every Sunday, as well as being able to stream Chris's ordination. And this, of course, will also put us one step closer to having members back in the church. Expect to see that plan and what will be required of you in the next week or two. Finally, stewardship packets will be mailed out this week. That includes some messages from both me and from Michelle Wagaman, our senior warden. And we're asking for you to return your pledge card to the office or fill out the pledge card online by November 22nd, that's the Sunday before Thanksgiving. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact me. I would love to have any discussion or help with anything I can. Thank you all so much for all the work you continue to do to support one another and to love the world. I am so grateful for your continued faithfulness. Our offertory hymn today is O Day of Peace. May you continue to love one another as Christ first loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice for the world. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessings through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. O God, the King eternal, whose light divides the day from the night and turns the shadow of death into the morning, drive far from us all wrong desires, incline our hearts to keep your law, and guide our feet in the way of peace, that having done your will with cheerfulness during the day, we may, when night comes, rejoice to give you thanks, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, our governor, bless the leaders of our land, that we may be a people at peace among ourselves and a blessing to other nations of the earth. To all in administrative authority, grant wisdom and grace in the exercise of their duties. To those who make our laws, give courage, wisdom, and foresight to provide for the needs of all our people and to fulfill our obligations in the community of nations. To the judges and officers of our courts, give understanding and integrity, that human rights may be safeguarded and justice served. And finally, teach our people to rely on your strength and to accept their responsibilities to their fellow citizens, that we may serve you faithfully in our generation and honor your holy name. Amen. Siblings in Christ, at this time, we are rightly separated one from another, and unable to gather around the Eucharistic table to break bread and drink wine. And because it is the desire of God's people to participate more fully in the life and ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ, let us now invite our Savior more deeply into our hearts by praying a prayer of spiritual communion. In union, O Lord, with your faithful people, at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist has been and will be celebrated, I desire to offer to you praise and thanksgiving. I remember your death, Lord Christ. I proclaim your resurrection. I await your coming in glory. Since I cannot receive you today in the sacrament of your body and blood, I explicitly ask you into my heart. Cleanse and strengthen me with your grace, Lord Jesus. Help me see all the ways in which you are still available, and let me never be separated from you. May I live in you and you in me in this life and in the life to come. Amen. And now please join in the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom the Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and the blessing of God Almighty, who comes to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Our closing hymn today is Jesus Shall Reign. Please join in singing.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.